Just to be called, everything was over. God's mercy. Amen. your way out of that no way. Amen. Amen. We have come upon the time that we're to give, and our scripture for our giving comes from 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter, and the 6th and 7th verses. It says, "Now this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must do just as he purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." Eternal God and Father, we thank you for this opportunity to give back to you that which you have given to us. We pray, O God, that you bless the ministry of good hope, and we pray that you bless those who give. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray, amen, and thank God. Now, we're going to have Brother Ed come. He's going to speak to us about different ways we can give to the ministry of good hope.
Keep your loving arms and protection around us. Keep your fist of protection. mankind. Oh, Heavenly Father, these are all the blessings we pray.
Others were cutting branches from the trees and spreading them in the road. The crowds going ahead of him and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." When he had entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirring, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." And our title for today is Jesus Enters Jerusalem. Jesus Enters Jerusalem. Amen. You can be seated. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for this opportunity to share your word. We pray that you will open our eyes that we might behold wondrous things out of your law. Speak to us through your word. Now let the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer, and all of God's children said, amen. Amen. Today is Palm Sunday, and what amazes me is how fast this year has gotten by us. It seems like only a few days ago we were just celebrating Christmas, and now we are in the Easter season. Now this kicks off the Passion Week, and Palm Sunday is the day that Christ enters into Jerusalem as the Messiah. So we celebrate this day, and we celebrate this week. Now, asked me, why do we call Friday Good Friday when Jesus died that day? What's good about dying and for us to celebrate it? And I said, you know, that is a good question. One of which I don't think very many of us have asked. Maybe we have thought about it, but I can't remember too many that question. Why do we call it Good Friday? Well, I thought about that, and then this was my answer. We know that death is not good. You know, nobody wants to die, right? But the death of Christ was different. The whole purpose of Jesus coming in the first place was for this momentous day, and that was to die. Christ's death wasn't like any other death in the history of humanity. Because when Christ died, something happened. When Christ died, God did something. He imputed the sin of us upon him. Right. And God declared us justified. Amen. I don't know about you, but that's good news. Amen. Because before that, if that had never taken place, we would be on our way to hell. There is nothing that you could have done about it. As best as you can, but your living a good life was not good enough to allow you to go to heaven. Isaiah said this: our righteousness is as filthy rags in comparison to the righteousness of God. At our very best, we're filthy rags. So we could never approach the throne of grace. But when Christ died on the cross, and some of us think of resurrection as when we were justified, but the scriptures tell us we were justified when Christ died on the cross. When he said, "It is finished," and he gave up the ghost, we were justified. And that is the reason why we call it Good Friday. Now, this day commemorates that beginning, that Passion weak when Christ is preparing to die for us. I want you to think about it. We just celebrated the Lord's Supper last week, and we were proclaiming his death until he come by way of recognizing and celebrating the Lord's Supper. But today we are celebrating the Messiah. Jesus the Christ is going into Jerusalem. It is Passover week. The Jews are celebrating and preparing themselves for the Passover. Now, the Passover is a commemoration of what God had done for Israel. Israel was in bondage in Egypt. You remember that story. Matter of fact, next week, every weekend, I don't know if they're doing it next weekend, I haven't checked the listings because I don't watch TV like I used to, but every Easter weekend, they show the Ten Commandments. Is that right? With Charleston Heston. Oh, they did it last night? Oh, see, I missed it. Well, they normally do it on Easter. Maybe Passover must be before Easter, something. But it always centers around Passover. Whenever Passover is, they show that. Well, Israel was in bondage in Egypt. And if you watched it last night, or if you ever watched it, it gives you a little background. Even though it's not lined up with the scriptures 100%, I'd say more like 50%. Making no less. A lot of it is not scriptural, but some of it is. One part that we know is scriptural is that Israel was in bondage in Egypt. But then God did an amazing thing by delivering them. But before he delivered them, he had to show Pharaoh and Egypt, give them one more sign of his power. And that was to allow the death angel to go Egypt land and kill the firstborn of every child, of every family. But what did he do for Israel, the children of God? He says those of that are of Israel that will take the blood of the lamb and put it over the doorposts of their houses, the death angel will pass over. But now, it could be any lamb. It had to be a lamb, the firstborn lamb, and it had to be without spot or blemish. Or in other words, it had to be a perfect sacrifice. Amen. Now, we come to this story, and the Israelites are preparing themselves for the Passover. They're commemorating the Passover, celebrating the Passover when they were delivered from bondage. And Christ, with this that Passover and that Passover lamb, was a foreshadowing of Christ's sacrifice. Now, Christ, the Passover lamb, the antitype of the type which was the Passover lamb, Christ is the antitype. He is preparing for his sacrifice. And he's going into Jerusalem to be offered up as a Passover lamb, not for a physical deliverance, but from bondage, but from a spiritual deliverance from bondage. Because all of us, every single one of us, were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And we were slaves to sin. Jesus came to set us free. Now, in the mind of the Jews, they thought of deliverance in one way. But they didn't know that God had another. did was he sent two disciples to get a donkey. Look what it says in verses 1 through 3. It says, when they had approached Jerusalem and had come to Bethphage,
fix it somehow.
we're able to look back and we can see what happened in the past. Well, that ain't too hard. You know, anybody can look at the past and see what happened. But how many can look to the future and tell you what's going to happen? But God, centuries earlier, said that the Messiah would come into Jerusalem on a donkey. He said this in Zechariah, the 9th chapter and the 9th verse, where he says that the Messiah would do this. Look what it says in our 4th verse of our text. It says, this took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. And that prophet happened to be Zechariah. And it says, to the Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, not on a war horse, not in a tank, but gentle and mounted on a donkey, even a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. He not just rode in on a donkey, he rode in on a baby donkey.
Whatever term, however that term is, they come right back. And
this is why God is magnificent, because he never fails, regardless of the circumstances, regardless of the situation, God's word will always come to pass. The crowd thought he was going, and one of the reasons why they said crucify Christ is because they felt that the Messiah was going to come in a different fashion. The crowd thought he was going to judge the Roman government and reestablish the kingdom of Israel. This is the thought they had. They knew David. They knew of the King David and Solomon, all the kings of Israel. And these kings were warriors. But here comes Jesus, this meek and humble lamb. He came to bring peace in his first coming. And what happened is they didn't know the plan of God. In Christ's first coming, he came to bring us peace. But in Christ's second coming, he will come to judge everyone. So now, as I said, God's word will come to pass. We know he came as a meek and humble lamb, his first coming. But he's coming as the Lion of Judah in his second coming. And the Bible is explicitly clear. It says that every deed and word spoken, can you imagine every word, every deed that you have ever done, be judged. You know, I can't even remember every word I spoke. I can't remember every deed I did. But God does. And if you have not been declared righteous by the blood of Christ, you will have to give an account for every deed done in the body. Yeah. Now, there are many of us that are a little reluctant to tell people that. We don't want people to be discouraged or people to be fearful. But you know, it's all right to be fearful if I'm warning you to get yourself right. We're studying the book of Genesis, and we're in the sixth chapter, and we're talking about Noah. And Noah gave a warning, but no one paid attention. And it took a long time before it came about. But when it came, there was no stopping. And many people are saying, well, you know, it's been 2,000 years and Jesus hasn't come back yet. We just live any kind of way. We do every kind of thing. But remember what I said when we said earlier, God will never fail. They promised him with their words that they will support him. Look what they said. Look what the crowd said. The crowd said, it says the crowd in verse 9, the crowds pointed ahead of him, and those followed were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. They praised him with their mouths. Luke 19, chapter 4, verse says this, Jesus said to the Pharisees that if the crowd didn't cry out, that the rocks would. In other words, the people had no choice. They had no choice but to shout, because it was fulfillment to the scripture, and the scripture had to be fulfilled. It was the will of God. They praised him with their mouth. They recognized that Christ was the Messiah, but they also recognized him with their actions. Look what they did. It says, when he entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirring, saying, who is this? The crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. The crowd recognized that Jesus was the Messiah. He was the lowly, humble Messiah. And as I said, they were looking for one riding on a war horse, but he came humbly. Look how he was born. He was born in a manger. He wasn't born in a palace. He wasn't born in a mansion. He wasn't born rich, but he was born to poor parents in a lowly manger. Look how he comes into Jerusalem. He didn't ride on some magnificent chariot, but he came riding on a donkey's coat. The kind of guy, he didn't die in war. He didn't die from that. He died on a cross, a humiliating death, a death that was reserved for criminals. Jesus died.
Thank you.